Hello everyone, I hope all of you are happy and hale. First of all, I would like to thank Indo Analytics for giving me this opportunity to address their audience on YouTube. To introduce myself, I am an engineer by profession, albeit my father was from the defense. He was an army officer. Ergo, I have a keen interest in defense related topics and strategic affairs. In fact, I write articles on the same on various websites. Without much ado, let me move to the topic I'm here to discuss with you. It is about how to make proxy war costlier for our enemy, or indirectly, how to counter proxy war at a cheaper cost for India. So let me begin by giving you some facts. Be it guerrilla war or clandestine operations, whenever a conventional army has to take upon an invisible enemy. When I say an invisible enemy, I mean someone who can camouflage himself or who can merge with the civilian population, like a terrorist. So, whenever a conventional army has to take upon such an enemy, the chances of winning of the conventional army is close to zilch. For example, Vietnam War. American army did not get anything out of Vietnam War. Closer home, India has been waging a proxy war since last 7 decades, and the enemy has been continuing it unabated against us. Since this has been going on since last 7 years, let us finally change the rules of this game by making it expensive for them. In an era of hybrid warfare, when hacking of satellites is a possibility, psychological warfare, cyber warfare are part of military postures of behemoth countries, India should be proactive in weaponizing intelligence information by resorting to coercive disclosure. In a little while, I'll tell you what I mean by weaponizing intelligence information and coercive disclosure. But before that, I want to make it clear that I strongly believe that waiting to use, or let's say saving intel information for future use, expecting a conventional war, is like waiting to eat a fruit after it rots. Now let's talk about the economics of proxy war. Let me give you an example. Last year, on 14th Feb, 46 CRPF personnel were killed in a suicide attack by a terrorist who belonged to JEM, Jaish-e-Mohammed. Consequently, Indian Air Force had sent its fighter planes to Pakistan. And that night, on 27th Feb, we had killed about 200 to 300 terrorists in the terrorist camp located in Balakot. But there are a few facts one must know. That the terrorist organization carried out the entire suicide operation at not more than rupees 40 lakhs. On the contrary, Indian Air Force, when they carried out the Balakot strike, our military assets worth rupees 6,300 crores were put at risk. Sukhoi 30 MKI that we had used, it cost about rupees 358 crores. 1,000 kgs of bombs costed us about rupees 1.7 crores. So what I'm trying to pencil in is that the terrorist organization was able to carry out the suicide attack at 100th the cost that we had to bear. But Balakot strike did change certain things. It was a turning point. It did force the enemy to change their strategy. Now the enemy has switched to non-contact warfare. By non-contact warfare, I mean enemy is now using a third party to carry out its operations on Indian soil. For example, the Shaheen Bagh protests. There's enough proof to prove that the Shaheen Bagh protests were funded by inimical elements located outside India. Now, when such violences are carried out, there's enough statistics which proves about it costs about such violences cost about 9% of our GDP every year. Can we not reduce this price? Of course we can. It just takes little political will. I do not want to overwhelm my audience with the cost of terrorism that India has been incurring since last few decades. So I'll stick to my topic of weaponizing intelligence information and coercive disclosures. So whilst I'm completely satisfied with the tectonic shift in security strategy introduced by our NSA Ajit Doval, somewhere I still feel that India relies heavily on conventional methods of attacking the enemy, which involves certain amount of risk for our forces. This can be reduced. Let me give you an example. On 5th of April 2020, there was an operation carried out by commanders of four para soldiers in Kupwara, Kashmir. That day we'd lost five commandos to a very bitter fight against terrorists. The ratio was 1:1. For every terrorist killed, we had lost one soldier. That is a pretty high number. And already in the valley, we are fighting in a Fibwa-like situation, which means, Fibwa means fighting in a built-up area. Now, the ratio of Fibwa, that means the terrorist killed versus soldier KIA, is 3.5:1, and it is same throughout the world. Not even America has been able to whittle down this number. At this point, I'm reminded of strategists like Sun Tzu and Chanakya, who had said the supreme art of fighting a war against an enemy is subduing the enemy without fighting. This is probably the most pragmatic way of preempting a terrorist strike. What we have to do is to release intel information to the right audience at the right time. Thereby, we can weaponize the intel information gleaned by our security forces. And this is exactly what I call the coercive disclosure. The idea is expose the enemy and their intention to the international audience. Let's say at United Nations General Assembly, what we have to do is selective publishing of intelligence information. We're not giving out everything. We are giving out only a part of the intelligence information, maybe at an international platform like UNGA or through some credible social media accounts. So what we really have to do is, we publish videos and pictures of terrorist camps located inside the enemy nation, and these can be videos and pictures gleaned through HumNet or satellites. I know this sounds counterintuitive to a lot of people out there, but trust me when I say, I have brainstormed this with a lot of veterans and serving officers. I have weighed the pros and cons of it. So this is no cock and bull theory that I am proposing. Those who are wondering if coercive disclosure really works or not, let me tell you, countries like Israel and America have already put the strategy to good use. Last year at UNGA, Benjamin Netanyahu, PM of Israel, had created a pandemonium of sorts when he revealed that there is an atomic warehouse located in Tehran, which is part of Iran. And also, he had gone on to give the exact location of missile building units located inside Lebanon. And these happen to be very populated areas. And in these units, dumb missiles were being converted into precision-guided missiles. You'll find more details of it in my article. Something similar was attempted by America in 2014. In 2014, American NSA had gone on to reveal how Russia was carrying out aggressive cyber attacks on its systems. In fact, they had videos of how Russian hackers were getting inside American systems and accessing different files. What this coercive disclosure by these countries had achieved was temporary suspension of enemies' activities, which is exactly what I'm proposing for India. Once we reveal such details of terrorist camps through our social media accounts, certain credible social media accounts, then it puts our enemy on his defensive foot. So let me reiterate what I was trying to underline here. Indian government should periodically give out locations of terrorist camps located inside Pakistan. This will put the enemy on defensive foot. Last year too, after the Balakot strikes, we had given out location of the terrorist camps which were attacked, but we were literally struggling to prove to the world that these were madrasas. This is exactly the point I'm trying to make. Even before we attempt a conventional war, let us try giving out these intel information and gauge the kind of damage it causes the enemy. What I think it'll achieve is, it'll not just put the enemy on a defensive foot, but it'll force the enemy to either deny the news or change, shift the terrorist camp out of its present location. Now, there are about 20 to 30 terrorist camps right now active inside Pakistan. So even if you were to give out location of one or two of these terrorist camps, it will be a huge blow to the PAK-backed terrorist camps, and certain veterans and serving officers give me more advantages of coercive disclosures, like shortening the decision cycle for our officers, bringing coherence among INT agencies within India. It'll also deter the inimical elements, and most of all, the most important of them all, is it'll force our ground staff to work on deeper and better INT. It'll improve their efficiency too. I really hope Indian Defence Forces step into terra incognita and do not shy away from utilizing their resources to inoculate Indian populace against cyber warfare. This is exactly what will help reduce the cost of proxy war for India. At this point, I would also like to add that I have complete faith in Indian government, which has been taking out-of-the-box solution to resolve issues. And I've really seen them take avant-garde approach to a lot of issues like demonetization, and that's exactly why I want my voice to reach the government, and I hope they adopt a strategy similar to coercive periodical disclosure. That's about it. All the best to Indian Defence Forces and the Indian government. To the audience who sat through the entire video, thank you so much for lending me your ears. And if you like the video, do give it a like and don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Thanks to my buddies from India Analytics who gave me this opportunity to address their audience on YouTube. And Stay safe, everyone. Ciao.